My name is Godworthy. Captain Resolution Godworthy. Former master of wooden ships. An iron man. Those few of you that know me know that I'm an old man. The rest of you can readily see I'm a damn well old man. Several weeks ago, a great desire came over me to visit the Captain Watson. He and I sailed together for years. So anyway, I drove up to Ben's house. Young Captain Benjamin Jr. came to the door. Oh, he said, Captain Resolution, I'm awfully glad to see you, but I'm terribly sorry to have to tell you this. Father, he slipped his cable and went aloft. That's the sailor's term for dying. Oh, I said, that's too bad, Benjamin. All of a sudden, he left the room and he came back with this case. He said, Captain, I'd like you to have this. Father built this. I said, I didn't realize he was such a craftsman in metal also. Oh, yes, he said. He made this case. And he put 7 coats of lacquer on it. And then he rubbed it down with the finest pumice from Mount Vesuvius, sifted through royal silk grown on the slopes of Mount Fujiyama in Japan. Oh, I said, Ben, I'd like to take it, but surely one of your 4 brothers or 5 sisters would want that. No, he said, if you don't take it, we're going to take it out off Block Island and commit it to the Deep 6. Oh, I said, really, Ben, I just can't see a beautiful piece of work like that being thrown over the side to the Deep 6. Well, he said, that's what's going to go. Well, I said, if you give me a good reason why I should have this. Well, he said, you know, my mother is a very, very frugal person. Very, very industrious. And my father was also. He hated to see anything go to waste. I said, yes, I know your father was a great saver. He was one of the best pack rats I've ever known. He said, well, mother being such an industrious person, when she died, Dad had her cremated and her ashes made into an hourglass.
The name Captain Resolution Godworthy actually came out of a novel. Resolution Godworthy was a private in the American Revolutionary Army. I believe the story took place someplace around Boston during the Battle of Bunker Hill or something like that. And when it came time to start to develop the character, when he started doing formal storytelling, he thought, well, all right, now what kind of a name can I take? Richard Baker is a fine name, but it doesn't really smack of that era, and he thought, oh, he remembered Resolution Godworthy, so he promoted him from private, made him a sea captain, and called himself Captain Resolution Godworthy. We pick up mail out of the mailbox addressed to Captain Resolution Godworthy, thing that come from other storytellers that come from the National Storytelling Center, and that type of thing come addressed to Captain Resolution Godworthy. I've often wondered what the mailman thinks.
Although I'm a man of the present, I am fortunate to have the background of a seafaring captain as a father, and my grandfather is an old whaleman, and I have taken some of my own experiences and built stories around them, but put it back in the windjammer area. During the Second War, I applied and was accepted to go to OCS, Officer Candidate School, Fort Trumbull, near London, Connecticut. And after graduating, I was sent to a replacement center in Baltimore and was assigned to a ship called the Grenville M. Dodge. I haven't been to sea for some nearly 30 years. Every once in a while, I get the longing to go back to sea. These are the kind of memories that just normally come back to you. The feel of the bridge, the controls, the absolute respect one received. There was only one higher authority than yourself, and that was God.
He's taken a lot of the things that happened to him, even at sea, in the 20th century, and redone them and reworked them and put them back in the 19th century that they might have happened to a sea captain.
Beat the quarters, Mr. Bruce, if you please. Sound the decks well, I fear a bloody engagement. Chain shot for the weather deck, round for the gunnery decks. Wear away, take the weather gauge of him now. I think this is more the aspect of what most people think of the seafaring and the windjammer days. I have a humble confession to make. My stories are basically, of course, seafaring deck stories, windjammer men, but I disgraced my family. My father was a ship's master, and my grandfather was a ship's master, but I'm black gang. I'm out of the engine room. My quarter century was spent at sea, down there, among the grease and the oil. Very few people have any concept of the engine room and the operation. Really, it's a dark, dusty, hot, miserable world without much glamour. The glamour is all on deck. Of course, I hope you realize that I'm a very honest man. I wouldn't tell you a dishonest thing. Well,
I've gotten some of the old girls worked up so terribly telling the story of losing my good friend Eddie Molosky, swept overboard, you know, just before Christmas. Eddie was a fine young man. He spoke English almost well enough so that you could understand him most of the time. Next thing you know, you got some of the old girls down there dabbing their eyes, and they're having a grand cry just like they've gone to a wake, you know, and they're getting two things, a chance to go to a wake and hear a little storytelling.
I'd like to tell you about an incident years ago. I paid off in Boston as a young man and decided I'd go down to Hyannis, visit an old shipmate of mine, Danny Slavin. I don't know as I really wanted to see Danny so much as I did a couple of those beautiful sisters of his. And his mother also had the reputation of making the finest stuffed clams on Cape Cod. Visiting Dan, I said that I'd like to make a trip on one of the big fishing schooners. And he said that Captain Bell was in from Nantucket. And Captain Bell had the reputation of being one of the finest readers of the ocean bottom on the fishing grounds out in the Georgia's banks and the Grand Banks. And the boys and the crew decided to have some fun with the old man this trip. So they took a little berth from Madam Hackett's yard and snuck it aboard. And this time of year, as you know, the fog hangs oftentimes for many days on the Georges. And we drifted out there in the fog for 5 or 6 days, and the old man had been running on dead reckoning and decided it was about time to take some soundings. And he told the boys to rig the deep sea lead. It's about 5 feet long, you know, and it's got a chamber drilled out in the bottom and you pack it with soap. And when it goes down on the bottom, the soap picks up the bottom, the mud or gravel or shell and gravel. And by looking at this, a man that knows his bottoms can get an approximate location of his vessel. So the boys went through the process of heaving the lead, but they didn't let it touch bottom because they had taken some of this earth from Madam Hackett's chicken yard. And they went through the motions of taking a deep sea sounding, hauled it aboard, and they took it aft for the old man, and he scrutinized it, looked at it, and he smelt of it.
Now, tasted it.
Ah, my God, he said, Nantucket Island sunk, and we're right over Madam Hackett's chicken run.
I think in storytelling, there has to be a little bit lying or fabrication to it to put color to it.
And to hold the interest of the one that's listening. They don't know whether you're telling the truth or not. They're just all engrossed in what you have to say.
Well, you can make you believe. I mean, I was sitting there thinking, is this true or is this just fantasy? That I really believe some of those stories.
He really looked the part. I mean, you could just picture him doing all the things that he said. It was very real. He felt very real and very involved. You became very involved in the things he was talking about and picturing, and you began to think he was really as old as he said he was.
I was a firm believer in every story that he told.
Well, I'll tell you the truth about this story. This is an original story. You won't find it written by any great author. It's mine. Some years ago, I was working at Mystic Seaport, and Captain Watson's first wife died. And I found him sitting in the sun on the west side of the Stillman Building. And I sat down alongside of him, and I truthfully, what do you say under circumstances? Cap, I'm terribly sorry to hear that Nancy passed away, and I knew them, you know. And yes, he said, Dix, you're the fine woman. And I do miss her terribly, but got quite a sense of humor. I made one mistake, and I said, what's that, Cap? And he said, well, I should have had her cremated and her ashes made into an hourglass. Well, you know, under the circumstances, I guess I smiled. I couldn't help it. And he said, that's all right, Dick. I realize a terrible thing to say. But several weeks later, a month or so, I went to a flea market on Greenman Avenue in Mystic, and I found this hourglass. And I purchased it. And I went home, and I made the case. And then I built the story around it with all the nonsense about Fujiyama and hummus. And
there's something personal about a storyteller standing in front of you and telling you a story, and there's kind of some give and take between you and the audience, and it brings the story to life.
The stories that I tell do not necessarily start absolutely word for word, and they won't be word for word all the way through, but the essence of the story is there. And that's where I think that the real old storyteller and the natural storyteller exists. Not taking the text, memorizing it. That's theater, pure and simple.
I think maybe in his heart of hearts, he'd like to go back and be a sea captain during the whaling era. I think that would suit him very, very much.
I remember the black wharfs and the tall ships and the sea tides tossing free, Spanish sailors with bearded lips, the beauty and mystery of the ships, and the magic of the sea. And oh, what pleasant visions haunt me as I gaze upon the sea, all the old romantic legends, all my dreams come back to me. Resolution Godworthy, your most humble servant.